So without further ado, please join me and welcome our very first speaker for today, Dr. Rajini, our Consultant Developmental Paediatrician, and with her topic, Early Intervention, the next step.
Hi, good morning, everyone. Morning to our distinguished guests, Ms. Chen, Dr. Chinker, Dr. Mehta, and everyone here present. I think everybody's distinguished here. And a very special hello to our little friends. Daniel, do you want to say hi?
Hi.
And a big warm applause for Abigail again. Abigail makes me feel very old. I've known Abby since she was young, so yeah, it brings... brings me back to my actual age now. I'm here to talk about early intervention, okay, and why it's so important. I get many parents coming in telling me that prior to seeing me, they always felt there was something different about their children from a very young age. Yeah, and some even as young as when they were infants. Some as they started walking, some as they were supposed to start talking. But a lot of times parents are often falsely reassured by the older generation or even by medical professionals, unfortunately. For me, when does early intervention start? Early intervention starts as early as you find there is a problem. So if we were to detect a problem when a woman is pregnant, the intervention starts then. You may look at me strangely, but we can start intervention because early intervention is not just about administering therapy, it's about educating parents, getting parents to accept and the diagnosis or the problems that their child is going to face. And if you don't get that acceptance, it's very difficult to start the intervention. So for me, the first step is about acceptance amongst the parents, educating parents, and then we move on from there. All of us are born with 15 million brain cells. Yeah? You can't make new ones. The ones you're born with are with you for life, and it's how you use them. If for some reason, you're deprived of particular senses, you're not going to be able to make new cells to replace those. Maybe stem cell therapy might change that, but we're a long, long way from there. But what we can do is to train the brain to take over functions that may be lacking. And that's the basis of early intervention. We're working on the plasticity of the brain. Yeah. So that starts very early on. What we know about early intervention is that it requires multiple inputs from different people. Firstly, from the parents, the most important people in the child's life. Then it maybe requires health professionals, allied health professionals, like speech therapists, physiotherapists, occupational therapists. It requires the extended family and the community, because we need to also help support that family when they're going through their journey. And then it requires the input of people like the welfare department, the education department, in terms of how what services we provide for these families in the community. In a hospital setting or a medical setting, what we aim to do is to first identify the problems that the children have. Once we've identified those problems, we may direct parents as to what they need to do. As we support these parents, the team themselves have to get together to decide if we're actually working towards the same goals. And that's another essence of an early intervention program. Interdisciplinary teamwork, or multidisciplinary teamwork, or transdisciplinary teamwork. All that means is a group of professionals working together with families in planning goals, in setting realistic goals, both short-term and long-term, with the aim that we are going to provide a program for the child that enables them to function as normally as possible in society. We do not aim to normalize a child, because what's normal? we're all not normal in a certain way, where we all have our own eccentricities. Hence, early intervention program is about starting early, it's about working together, setting goals with the aim that we minimize disability and we maximize potential. That's the essence of an early intervention program. What sort of programs exist depends on what's available in the community. If you come to a setting like this, we have professionals who provide services in the forms of physiotherapy, occupational therapy, speech therapy, audiology, optometry, where we look at vision, something that people don't often think about in children who have different disabilities. We also have audiologists who look at hearing, and not just hearing, but other aspects of listening and hearing as well. We also have many doctors here who are able to provide support services in helping a child develop and manage their medical problems along the way. Beyond that, we need to look outside in the community, okay? Because children need to go to preschools, children need to go to primary schools, secondary schools, or to centers that are able to help them progress along. We understand that. And what's important for the multidisciplinary team in an early intervention program is about providing parents the right information and the right support when their children are in the schools. And again, this is how a team providing early intervention services should be working. And we aim to provide that here. I just want to wrap up by saying, as much as parents hope that their child becomes normal, it's not always possible. And that's where we as a community, as a nation, need to move on. We have been very blessed that we have been able to improve early intervention services here in Malaysia. What we have not done is the next step. And I hope that we are able to think about the next step, so that we have children like Abby who are able to use their talents in society, children like Andrew who are able to showcase their fantastic art and make a living out of it, children like Leah who are able to support their sister, and even one day Adele may be making cupcakes. We won't know. Yeah. But we as a community and a society need to move on and help children as they grow up, following their intervention. Thank you.